Good morning, church, and welcome. This is a beautiful day, and we are so glad to see each and every one of you here today. And as we begin our worship with praise, we ask God's blessing upon us, that you will all receive a blessing.
And our first praise will be a YouTube call. Now is the time to worship. Please worship with us. The lyrics will be over here to play on us.
Children. Can they come in? Bring the children.
I've got joy.
As the children come to us, let us sing with them this morning. Come on.
still all coming.
Joy down in our heart. Let we all join the children, have that joy.
You all have to come back next week, okay?
Yes.
You were great. Thank you.
Praise God.
That's what we need.
What we will do without little children. Our next song is Holy Sabbath Day of Rest by our Master Richly Blessed.
May you please stand and sing that song with us, please.
Blessed into us
Jesus' feet. Yes, the holy Sabbath rest by the good divinely blessed. It to us a shine shall be. Asking him for saving grace, also victory in the race, and to help us by his power to keep holy every hour.
Stand in the Lord is in holy temple.
The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord is in his holy temple.
Bible, Star of Gladness Gleaming, our opening song. Let us all sing together.
Give me the Bible, Star of Gladness Gleaming, to cheer the wonder, long and tempting storms. No storm can hide that peaceful radiant beaming. Sing Jesus came to seek and save the lost. Give me the Bible, holy message shining. Thy light shall guide me in the narrow way. Precepts and promise, Lord, and all combining, till night vanished in eternal day. Give me the Bible when my heart is broken, when sin and grief fill my soul with fear. Give me the precious word by Jesus spoken, all of faith left to show my Savior dear. Give me the Bible, holy message shining. Thy life shall guide me in the narrow way. Precept and promise, law and love combining, till I shall die. Teach me the dangers of this rebellion. Thy lamp will save me, for the glow shall brighten that light along the path of peace can show. Give me the Bible, holy message shining. Thy light shall guide me in the narrow way. Precepts and promise, law and love combining, till I shall vanish in eternal day.
Let us pray. Everlasting Lord, we are thankful for your sun have shined in the sky.
Amen.
And your sun has shined in our hearts.
Amen.
May we ever be grateful and remember to keep the holy Sabbath as you have commanded, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Yes, you can be seated. Take a break. Just want to say welcome to everyone this morning, as well as those who are watching us live streaming. You know, they are part of our church family too, even though they don't come here. But we want to invite them to come out and spend some time with us and just enjoy the program that we have going on here. I think they would enjoy it. Yeah, okay, very well. I guess you can hear me a little better now, right? Should I say welcome to everyone again? Okay, welcome to everyone. Hope you had a wonderful week. Hope you're here feeling spiritual, feeling like just praising the Lord, because this is what this day is all about. And again, for those who are watching us live streaming, we hope you enjoy the service as well. Pastor had reported to Elder Kip last week that through the website there was about 40 people who called in and gave good comments concerning the Sabbath school. I said, praise the Lord. You know, I'd like to encourage some more of us to come on out to Sabbath school. You know, they're saying that these lessons are designed to prepare us for translation. Man, that sounds like things are getting close, right?
Yeah.
It's like, you know, you're going to take a trip to New York and you went out and bought your ticket. And you get ready to go down to the airport, but we don't have to go to no airport. We don't have to go into place. Jesus has promised to come and get us. And I'm convinced in the depth of my heart that he will. And I also want to report to you all that, you know, we weren't for a while doing so well with prayer meeting. I remember the times just Pastor Mr. Jim was here, but things began to grow and turn around. The Lord began to bless and lay on hearts. And I think this week we had like 13 present.
Amen.
And we prayed for the prayer cards, and we do that. We did what we promised you that we would do. And I think there's blessings going on around this church right here. Prayer cards are in the pews. Fill them out. The elders pray concerning the prayer cards or whatever the problems are. And if you send out a thanks to the Lord, we also take that to him. So Lord, such and such a person said thank you for your blessings. So I hope you will just go ahead and fill out the prayer cards. You know, at the appropriate time, we'll come down and we'll pick up those prayer cards. And we're going to make sure that we take them before the Lord. The next thing, we were supposed to begin an AYS for, who is it, for the youth?
Yes.
Or just for the young?
And the young and
hard. Young and hard as well, that's right. So we're looking for everybody to come out when? The second Sabbath of February. In the evening, we are going to have AY here. I was talking to Miss Leanne, and I was telling her, you know, here you might have a little more adults come out than children. We hope that's not the case. But she said she would have something, a program, that would be fitting for everyone. Yes, that's what she told me. So, amen. Okay then. We're looking forward to that. Huh? I think the date on that is when? The 10th?
The second.
Yeah, the second Sabbath. Okay. Now, we also had been talking about every second Sabbath, and we haven't gotten there yet. We would like to see the church have a social. We would like to come out here and play some games and have some fun, loving on each other. That's important. That is very, very important. Play together and stay together. You know, I was thinking about, you know, these things get started off a little bit slow. I remember prayer meeting, like I told you, prayer meeting was very slow. But it's moving forward as people realize that you're going to be there, they will come. You know, somebody went down and put a vegetable stand or something on the corner of Cox Road and 524, you know, things would begin to move kind of slow. Because people don't know who you are, how long you're going to be there. But as you stay there and continue to be there, after about a year, guess what? Folks will be down there waiting for you to open up. So the same rules, it's just people, and the same rules apply. And as we get started with AYS, it may be a little bit slow, but if we stay at it, the socials and everything else, we'll find that they will begin to grow. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Now, there's one more thing, and I'm going to sit down, because I know somebody's saying, when is he going to sit down? Listen, I'm not the pastor here. I kind of replaces him when he's not here to do doing whatever needs to be done, really. But primarily, the announcements fall to me. But the pastor is Dr. Dan Schiffbauer. He's here every other Sabbath. His information is up there. They place it up there. He's our pastor. And if you need to contact him, you can use that number. Give a little time to copy it down, put it in your phone or whatever. This is the last thing I want to share with you all. And I don't want to be frightening. I would rather be enlightening. Beginning in 2023, our first big debt was about $175,000. We wanted a school back here. And we was in debt to the conference, to the school system over there. And they didn't think that we would ever have a school here again. But before half of the year taking place, the church had managed to pay off the $175,000 and begin plans for a school. I say amen. What do you think about that?
Amen.
Oh man. Let me give you a little more. I said I don't intend to frighten, just enlighten. The church needed an alarm system. Had to have it. The system was just going off, alerting the police, and the police would come out here, and whenever, or the fire, or whoever come out here, there was a bill for about $500, and we had to get rid of that. System was going off on its own. So we had to go and buy or replace the alarm system, which cost us about $30,000. Amen? No, amen. Not only that, an insurance bill came. And that bill also was another $30,000. Just in case that's not enough, we had a hurricane that ripped some of the tiles off the roof, and for a moment there, the insurance company was going to pay to have the roof repaired, but when the conference took a look at the roof, hadn't been repaired over 30 years, they're saying, why would you try to patch something like that? So they decided that we needed a new roof, about $60,000. You're still adding? We picked up a tax bill this year, finally, for about $6,000. Somebody said, Brother Wolf, what are you trying to say? The funds are depleted. But Psalms 24 says, the earth is the Lord, and the fullness thereof, and they that dwell therein. Everything we belong to the Lord. Everything we got belongs to the Lord. Amen. So when the Lord needs, we need to give. Because when we need, what? He gives. He blesses. I'm not talking about, sometimes he'd always put a lot of money in our pocket, but that person that we might have in jail, and we've been concerned about him, he might send him home to us. That's a blessing.
Amen.
Somebody we got in the hospital, who we think is terminal and about to die, and God sent him home to us. That's a blessing. There's a whole lot of things God do for us. That's a blessing. I want to get down here because somebody else is going to preach. I just want to enlighten you all, try to encourage you all what you need to do. I know Pastor mentioned something last week, said he himself has decided to double the funds that he put into the church. And I myself said it belongs to the Lord. I'm going to double the funds also that I place within the church. So if anybody can help, reach out and help. Thank you all so very much. Do we have a first-time visitor this morning? And I'm going to be going here in a second. Somebody who's never been with us. You see a hand? My eyes don't see a hand. But the Lord still helped me here, standing here working. Is there a hand? I thought I saw somebody. Stand up for me then if there's somebody. I'll see you then. Thank you. Nobody. All of this we have is just church family?
Amen.
I say amen. Is nothing wrong with that? Should we take a little time out and welcome each other to the house of the Lord this morning?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, very well. Why don't we get up, handshake, hug? Whatever means you want to use, but just welcome each other to the house of the Lord this morning. Thank you also very, very much for your patience and love.
Man, I don't know how you show up here without the axe, man.
Doing good.
If I knew you were coming.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made.
Okay, children, come on up for your story. Happy Sabbath. How you guys doing? Good? Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath. Did you guys have a good week?
You look very lovely today. I like your dresses. Very nice. Did you dress yourself? Good job. You did good job. Okay, I have a special story for you today, but I need some help. Who here knows what the word lazy means? Does anybody know?
I forgot now.
Tell me what you think it is.
Being don't want to do it.
Okay, don't want to do anything. Okay, all right, so I'm going to tell you a story that happened long time ago, and it is about a sergeant. And this sergeant name is Sergeant Be Alert. What's his name? Sergeant Be Alert. Let's say it again. Sergeant Be Alert. Okay, now Sergeant Be Alert was always on top of his game. He was ranked a high sergeant, and he took care of his troops, and he always did what was right. And anytime there was something going on, he and his troops were always ready. If there was a war coming, he knew ahead of time, and he got everybody ready and prepared. So one day, Sergeant, what's his name? Be Alert, got called into his lieutenant's office. And he came in and he said, "Yes, sir, how can I be of assistance to you?" And the lieutenant said, "Sergeant," what's his name? Sergeant? "Yes, I have a mission for you. I need you to go to Lazy Dia. Now, this is a small place what you probably never heard of, but they need help over there with their troops. There is a war that's coming and they are not ready. So I need you to go over there and see what's going on." So Sergeant, what's his name?
Beeler.
Yes, he went on his mission. And when he got there, boy, oh boy, guess what he saw? The soldiers were a mess. Their uniforms were untucked and they were untidy. They didn't make their beds. They were just laying around being lazy. Yes, so Sergeant, what's his name?
Beeler.
Yes, came and said, "Men, attention." And they looked at him and said, "Who's this guy?" And he said, "I am Sergeant
Beeler.
And you guys need to get ready. There's a war coming." And they looked at him and said, "I don't think so. There hasn't been a war here in so long." So he said, "Listen, guys, you need to get ready. Come on, get up." So the soldiers slowly got up and they were moving in slow motion. So they got their outfits tucked in and they got up and they stood there. And Sergeant
Be alert
said, "Come on, guys, let's get it together." So he would give them chores to do, and each morning he would ring that bell at 5 a.m. Ding-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling. Time to get up. Get up, guys. Come on. Let's go. Let's go. In line. Order. Order. And guess what? How do you think they moved? In slow motion. They got in line. They yawned. They said, "Sergeant,
be alert.
We are so tired." And what do you do when you're tired? You yawn and then you rub your eyes. "Nobody's coming. It's been so long since we had a war." And then guess what? Sergeant Be Alert said, "We always have to be alert. You never know what can happen." Yes, you always have to be alert. So time passed by, and every day Sergeant Be Alert would try and get the troops ready. But then guess what happened? Because of his soldiers not being ready, he fell into the slump of laziness. And he would get up late too. And then he would hang out on the beach, and then after he would just be like, "Nothing's happening. It's been so long." So one particular night, while everybody was sleeping, guess what? Troops from another part came in, and they were using their binoculars and looking, and they saw everybody was sleeping. So they waited till the next morning, and they still looked, and they said, "Those soldiers look so lazy. They're just hanging on the beach. They're not paying attention to what's going on. We should be able to take over their island." So the troops got ready that night, and everybody was asleep. And then they came and they took over the whole island. And guess what? Nobody was prepared because they were lazy and sleeping and not paying attention. They were not alert at all. Wow. So that's not too good, right? You always have to be alert. Okay, so it's important. The message to the story is very important. You know why? Because Jesus is coming soon, and we, as soldiers, need to spend time reading our Bible. What else do we need to do?
Pray.
Pray and watch every day. Okay, so let's sing a song. Remember that song, "Read Your Bible, Pray Every Day"?
Yeah.
Let's sing that song. Set a timer. Okay, so let's sing that song. All right, after three. Church, can you help us? Okay, 1, 2, 3. Read your Bible, pray every day, pray every day, pray every day. Read your Bible, pray every, and you do what? Grow. Show me growing. Are you growing? And you grow, grow, grow. And you grow, grow, grow. Read your Bibles, pray every day, and you grow, grow, grow. Now neglect your Bible. What happens? Neglect your Bible. Forget to pray. Forget to pray. Forget to pray. Neglect your Bible. Forget to pray. And you what? And you shrink. Shrink. Get shrink. Lower. Shrink with me. And you shrink. 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 Getting lower. And you shrink. 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 Neglect your Bibles. Forget to pray. And you shrink. 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 Okay, so do you promise to read your Bible and pray every day? Okay, thank you. And please pray for me, okay? All right, and I'll pray for you. All right, who would like to pray? Okay, we'll have two prayers, okay?
Every day I got, every Sunday I pray to God on every day Sunday. Our Lord.
Bless our families.
Bless our church.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Dear Jesus, thank you for our day. Thank you for our friends. Thank you for everybody coming to church today and having the good Sabbath for church. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Okay, let's go and collect offering. Get your baskets. Yes, of course. Thank you.
Happy Sabbath, Church. It is no time for tithe and offering, but before we do that, I just want to ask, we get help every day from the Lord, right? What do we give back in return? Because you know that in life, For every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction, right? Yeah. So I will read something from the psalmist, help from the Lord. I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. Thank you. Will the deacons come forward? Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus for your presence with us today. Father God, open our hearts to receive your blessings. Please bless these offerings that we're about to lift, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning again, saints. Those prayer cards, am I coming? Okay, very well. That we talked about earlier are those prayer or praise cards. We'll pick them up at this time. But if anybody here have a blessing.
Hey, Ben.
That happened this week.
Ben.
Yes, ma'am.
I have to tell you how good God is.
Amen.
Even when you don't think he's watching over you.
Yes.
He is watching over you. Okay. This week, somebody came to me and told me, you've got a secret. And I said, what kind of secret do I have? And they said, you've been driving since 1222 without a tag on the back of your license plate. And I said, that can't be right. I buy my tag every year. So I went right to the DMV. And I said, either somebody stole my little tag or I didn't buy one. And so she says, give me your license, I'll look it up. So she gave me, I gave her my license and she looked it up. She says, you haven't bought a ticket since 1222. And I said, praise the Lord that he has kept me these 2 years without tickets or anything. I am praising him.
Amen, amen, yes, yes. That's a praise report now. Yes. Is there someone else before we go before the throne of grace?
Greetings, brothers and sisters.
Good evening. Good morning. Which? It's not afternoon yet. Okay. Good morning.
I just want to praise the Lord for his mercy.
Amen. Yes, yes. You said for the message? For his mercies. Thank you. I'm going to get my hearing aids. Yeah, next month. I should have had them. I missed my appointment to go pick them up. But they are in process. Then I will hear everybody who's talking about me.
Okay. I was a bit reluctant to share, but last Sunday I was on the 95 with my granddaughter. We were heading back from Palm Bay, and I was in the middle lane in front of one of those truck car haulers. It was really very long. And as we reached to that little bump in the road where Ogali, we are heading north, I saw a man in the road. I was going at about 65 miles an hour. The truck was ahead of me. And the bike was going around and around. And my granddaughter grabbed my arm and said, Grandma, stop. And I'm like, not in the middle of the road, because there were cars behind me. So I quickly, I don't know, I just... God is good. God is good.
Amen.
I just felt myself going in the other lane, the left lane. I don't know what happened. I can't tell you that consciously I did what I did or I knew what happened, but I knew I saw somebody. He had a helmet on, and I saw the bike going round and round. I turned and I went off to the soft shoulder and I called the cops, and they came and they did their investigations. But the truck had a dash cam that showed everything that happened, because I'm like, Lord Jesus, did I run over his legs? Did I run over? But the front of my car, the front tire, the right side, got the bike, got me there. And then it sort of tore off a little part of the bumper there. But, you know, I thank God. I thank God, because it could have been different.
Amen.
God is good. God is good.
Amen. Amen. Well, what about one verse of what a friend we have in Jesus?
One minute.
You say you got one more?
Yeah.
Okay, very well.
I just wanted to praise God for the wherewithal for my wife, Melissa Simser.
Amen.
She's been doing a lot of volunteer work, and they are, right now they're doing a census for all the homeless in the area, and she went out yesterday and and searched homeless camps and went out into the woods and just found, you know, mentally unstable people, some people that were completely healthy, that had jobs and everything, that were just homeless. And we got to keep a special prayer in our hearts for all those people that are just going through life and yes, going through the so struggles.
Much. Amen. 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 Amen.
Thank you.
Praise God for Melissa.
One more, Ben.
One more. Okay.
I just want to thank the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost for bringing me to church today. And I love you all and be blessed.
Amen, amen. Okay, let's move forward. Just one verse of What a Friend. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sin griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. As much as possible, saints, let us go to our bending knees before our Lord. Father in heaven, dear Lord, we humble our hearts as we approach the throne of grace. We come this morning as a church family. We want to say thanks to you, dear Lord, for your abundance. And we ask, dear Lord, your forgiveness where we have come short of the glory of God. We ask, O Lord, if you would wash us in the precious blood of the Lamb, cleanse us, O Lord, fill us anew with your precious Holy Spirit. May there be power in all of our lives, Lord, to gain the victory and be all that we can be for you. We want to ask a special blessing today, dear Lord, upon our visitors. We want to ask a special blessing, dear Lord, upon the sick. And again, dear Lord, we'd like to ask a special blessing upon the manservant that you have sent to us to break the bread of life. Be with him, dear Lord, and give him clarity of mind, dear Father, the things that he has, that you had given him to present to us, dear Lord, and may we receive them without fault. And Lord, we just ask that you be with him in a very special way. Now, dear Lord, we ask a blessing upon this church, dear Father. I talked this morning, dear Lord, about its financial situation, but the song that we just sang said, take everything to God in prayer. We know, dear Lord, that there is nothing that is too much for you. There is no malady, no problem, no situation, dear Lord, that you can't fix. And Lord, we know that we serve a risen Savior, one that's in the world today. We know that he is living whatever men may say. We see his hands of mercy. We hear his voice of cheer. And whenever we need him, he's always there. We're talking about Jesus, our Lord and Savior. We're so thankful for him. We know, dear Lord, that he didn't have to do what he did. It was because of his great love for us that he left heaven with all of the splendor and grandeur and came to this earth in the likeness of sinful flesh, dear Lord, that we all may be restored and have a right to the tree of life. And we just again want to thank you for him. We want to thank you, dear Lord, for our church family as well as our pastor. And again, dear Lord, bless our speaker today. We just want to thank you and praise you because you are always there for us. You said, I will never leave nor forsake thee. Bless us again, we pray. In Jesus' precious and holy name, amen. Hear our prayer, O Lord. Hear our prayers, O Lord. Incline thine ear to us and grant us thy peace. Amen.
The scripture reading is taken from Luke 22, verses 36 to 39. Then said he unto them, But now he that hath a purse, let him take it, and likewise his scrip. And he that hath no sword, let him sell his garment and buy one. For I say unto you that this that is written must yet be accomplished in me. And he was reckoned among the transgressors, for the things concerning me have an end. And they said, Lord, behold, here are two swords. And he said unto them, It is enough. And he came out and went as he was wont to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples also followed him. May God have a rich blessing to the reading of his word. At this time, we will have special music by Sister Rosa, and after that, our brother Doug Mapp will bring the breath of life to us. Thank you.
Hello, church. Good afternoon. Happy Sabbath.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well.
Thank you. That was beautiful. I think by now that most of you who worship in this place know that I have adopted a new policy. And I am told, so are you, that when you give a testimony for the Lord, no matter how often you give that testimony, it always brings glory to God. Well, thinking about that statement helped me to realize something else as well. Every counsel of God's word is relevant to you at each moment of your life. And I repeat this. Whenever I do the Sabbath school or whenever I ask now to speak, that Jesus said something to Nicodemus, which becomes a key. He said, "Except." So that prefaces everything else that's following. "Except you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of heaven." And then he later would teach that the kingdom of heaven would be where? It's in you. Well, how are you going to experience the kingdom of heaven if Jesus said that except you be born again, you can't see it? So I adopted a new policy. And that policy is that before I speak, and I admonish this to you elders as well, I'm going to ask God to give every one of us that born again experience right now, so that the message that is preached, you will be able to receive it. So whosoever will, I'm inviting you to come down that you could pray with me. And while I am praying, you pray also and ask God to give you that born-again experience. Some of us need to come and pray not only for ourselves, but we need to pray on behalf of our children. Amen. I am reminded often of Sister Ruby Reichman's son, Eddie.
Thank you.
Who went to school with our children. And she has been repeatedly asking for prayer. I'll invite you to kneel as far as possible. If you can't, then you can sit. Everlasting Lord, we come before your throne of grace because this is a solemn hour. The things that we have need of, we are unable to achieve. We cannot acquire them, Lord. But the one thing that we can do is ask you to give us that born-again experience of which you spoke, that each one of our hearts might be emptied of self, and that you will fill us with your Holy Spirit's presence so that we would be able to see the kingdom of heaven. Grant us thy peace, Lord, we pray. Answer the prayers of all your people. For we are gathered here at the throne of grace, O Lord, seeking a blessing to be lifted up. And Lord, I specifically want to mention Eddie Reichman. This young man, Lord, whom you blessed to grow up in this church, in this area, to attend this school, is having a difficult time because the enemy has targeted him. And so we pray in the name of Jesus that you will strengthen his mother's prayers and continue to give him strength and mind that he might know that you love him and that you want to save him. Do this not only for him, Lord, but for all of us and all of our children. It's my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. You could return to your seats. And thank you for coming. While you're returning to your seat, you know, I decided to do something today that I have not done. Been wanting to do it for a while, but didn't. And you may have seen me sitting here with my phone in my hand. You know, it's amazing how times change. And I sat there actually sending out text invitations of our live stream. I was sitting there sending the live stream text to friends and family so that they could join us. That's something that every single one of us ought to do. Now, I want to take a moment to also say that if you have a device that looks like this, you have no excuse why you don't have a Bible and why you don't have access or have downloaded Ellen G. White's writings. You'll understand why. So we are told about the story of the fall of Lucifer. I, while sharing a Sabbath school lesson one day, said that we were studying the lesson of missionaries. And I made a statement that the very first missionary was God himself. And I showed how, because of the fall of Lucifer, God went into active missions to recover the lost. And so today we know that missionaries go out often to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with those whom they presume don't know him. Well, the story of the fall of Lucifer posed somewhat of a dilemma. And when you stop to think about this, the way in which we look at the Bible, the way in which we understand what we're told, is somewhat of a challenge for the Spirit of God. And I'll tell you why. When you open up a Bible, what do you see? You see well-defined books. You see chapters, verses. But do you know that when those writers wrote those, they did not put chapters and verses in place? Makes you think. So if you look at the Bible and you pay attention to what the writers who were writing it were seeking to convey, you would understand that they were simply writing a stream of information that had been shown to them, and the context of all this information all depended on the words going from the beginning to the end. So in other words, instead of just stopping at chapter 1 and laying the Bible aside to read chapter 2 for some other time, they just wrote. And if you read it the way it was written, you'd never stop until you concluded the book. That tells us something. Because our understanding of the Bible has to be carefully considered when we sit down to read it. And you know, we often hear and talk about what we're supposed to do, our responsibilities when it comes to our personal development in Christ. And it made me start thinking about something. We are in a warfare. We didn't ask to be put in the warfare, but we're in it. And when I started to look at this lesson for today, I began to realize something. See, Lucifer created a dilemma for himself. But what he did, he realized, left him in deep trouble. Because he understood the nature of God, and he understood the commands of God. And he also understood that once he stepped out of his position to take up a strife against God, there was only going to be one end. When you read that story, it says that he decided to set his throne above the throne of God. Well, I don't know how he thought about doing that, because if you could put out life, how will you continue to exist? You can't. But nevertheless, this was what he did. But Lucifer got smart enough to figure one thing out. And this is the one thing that many of us have not figured out. He thought about that thing, what he had done, and said, "I am destined for death. And the only way that I can prolong that until I can figure out another way to survive is I have to create another dilemma." And so guess what he did? He started to spread that rebellion throughout heaven. And when he was done spreading it throughout heaven sufficient, he started to spread it to all the unfallen worlds. None of them, except for the angels in heaven that would follow him, took it up. But the problem was, now, not only himself and those fallen angels having been kicked out of heaven, but they were all going to share that fate, because he could convince none other that God was an arbitrary God who only thought about himself. He couldn't convince the rest of the creation of this. So he comes down to earth. After God had now created Adam and Eve and have given them his instructions, Lucifer stood up and said, "I can't trust any one of you with this next step. I must cause the fall of Adam and Eve." And do you know why? Because he needed to borrow time. You see, he saw what God did for him. He saw what God had done. And he knew that the character of God does not change. Therefore, if God put out so much labor to save me, surely if I get them to fall, he's going to put up time to save them. That was a master plan how to continue or prolong his life. Get man to fall. We all are aware today, sitting in this church and looking online, that that plan basically worked. He was able to prolong his existence because now Adam and Eve were in trouble. I want to submit to you today. Think about this. Every time the devil is capable and able to cause you to do something contrary to God's will, he is buying more time. We talk about we want Jesus to come back. but we still struggle. You know, the Bible tells us in the book of Philippians chapter 2, it says, let this what? Mind. Be in where? Which was also in? How did Christ get that mind? How did he get it? Oh, and by the way, you know, when I was young, I used to preach. Claudette used to tease me. Now I got old, and I realized that I'm teaching and not preaching. So you could talk back to me, okay? How did Christ get that mind? Okay. Someone else. How did Christ get that mind? Scripture. That's a good answer. Matthew chapter 4, brother. Matthew chapter 4 and verse 4. Starting at verse 4. My sermon title for today is Those Swords. I don't know if you ever did list it, but in case he didn't, the sermon title is Those Swords. So Matthew chapter 4 verse 4, let us read this. But he answered and said, it is what? Written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. Continue it on. Then the devil taketh him up into the holy city, and setteth him on a pinnacle of the temple, and said unto him, if thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down, for it is written. Notice this. Not only is Jesus saying, it is written, the devil is saying, it is written. Okay? He shall give his angels charge concerning thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. And verse 7. And Jesus said unto him, oh, wait, that's right. But what did he say? It is written what? What does that signify? It tells you that Christ is repeating a process. First it said, it is written. Then it comes back this time and says, it is written again. And when we continue on in this narrative, for the sake of time, I'm not going to continue it, reading it. But we know that when Satan came to him the third time and said to him, bow down and worship me, Jesus said, it is written. You will never get the mind of Christ until you are willing to commit to memory the words of God. Now, let me tell you, if you have time to turn on your television in your house, you have time to memorize the Word of God. The question you have to ask yourself is salvation worth it to me enough for me to do that? Is it worth it? Because if your enemy understands and knows what is written, and by the way, that situation that we just read did not happen at an organized Bible study. It happened in the wilderness between two individuals who did not have the scrolls when they were reading when they were reciting what was written. They had to know or memorize the text in order for them to quote those texts. Well, if Jesus knew that he needed to memorize the Bible in order to stand firm against evil, what about us? Our scripture reading is in the book of Luke, chapter 22. Can you put that up, please? We're talking about two swords. And the narrative that is described in chapter 22 tells us about Jesus about to go to the Garden of Gethsemane. His earthly ministry comes to a conclusion, and he is telling the disciples that I'm about to send you out. As verse 36 reads, "Then said he unto them, But now he that hath a purse, let him take it, and likewise his scrip. And he that hath no sword, let him sell his garment and buy one." This is kind of an unusual instructions being given, because Jesus is going to have an encounter, and again, for the sake of time, we're going to bypass going to the continuing in the text, but you can go home and see this again and catch these texts, study them. As a matter of fact, I want to submit to you, memorize them. And I'm telling myself that. But nevertheless, Jesus knows that he is about to encounter the Garden of Gethsemane experience. And when he gets there and the rabble comes out to arrest him, Jesus is telling how many disciples? He has 12 disciples, right? He says to them, if you have a garment, and of course they all were wearing garments, he's saying that this battle that you're about to enter in is so fierce that I'm advising you to sell your garment and buy you a sword. 12 disciples. If we continue reading that text, you will notice that one of the disciples said to him, Lord, there are how many? Do you know? Put the text back up, please. Let us continue it. And they said, Lord, behold, here are how many? Two swords. And he said unto them, what? Now, something's wrong with Jesus' math. I have several sermons, and one of them was entitled Strange Mathematics, and it basically covers somewhat of this same text. How in the world are you going to instruct 12 men to sell a garment and buy a sword and then turn around and say to them, when they tell you they have two swords and you say it's enough? You wanted to say something, but you speak up though. Wait, see, I didn't hear him. So we need to get a microphone on the floor.
He said there'd be only 11 disciples because Judas had asked him.
Well, that's true. And that's very true. You're right. Thank you for that correction. He said that there were 11 disciples, not 12. You're right, because one had ran off. But even so, you got 11 men, two swords. Jesus tells them, sell your garment and buy a sword, and they say, we have two, and then he says, it's enough. That's strange. Because what that tells me is that 9 people are going to basically be without a sword, unless, what's the obvious? What's the obvious?
The sword is the word.
Okay, so somebody said the sword is the word. But now that's a problem, and I'll tell you why. Because those disciples went down into the Garden of Gethsemane, and when the rabble came to arrest Jesus, what happened? So who had the sword?
Peter.
Okay, so now I'm going to go with the sword is the word. I'm going to take that. But this was a very real challenge. And trust me, Jesus knew that Peter was going to draw a sword and cut off somebody's ear. So there are several things that's going on. First of all, You're right. When Jesus said to them that the two swords were enough, what was he actually saying? Everything that you need for the battle that you are about to go in requires two swords, that's enough. Funny thing about this is, who knew who had the swords? Who knew? Who? I'm not hearing it clearly. Somebody said Peter.
Jesus.
Jesus, okay. All of them who were in the room knew who had the two swords. They all knew. Interestingly enough, we are told that Peter had one of them. And the interesting thing about this story, and I've sat and learned and heard preachers teach and preach about Peter being a poor swordsman because he swung at the guy's head, he missed and got his ear. They say he was a poor swordsman. And I contend that he was an excellent swordsman. You know why? Because the sword was representative of the Word of God. And the Bible says that faith cometh by what? Hearing. And hearing by the what? Word. So when he swung, what did he hit? What do you hear with? The Word of God is to hit you in the ear. And so when he did this, Jesus allowed that whole scenario to go the way it went. He chopped off the guy's ear, but Christ reached down, he picked it up, and he put it back. And then he said to him, put up the sword, because if you live by that sword, you're going to die by it. Okay, so going to the book of Ephesians chapter 6. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 6. And we want to look at verse 13. Very quickly, and then we're going to do 13, and then we're going to go to 17. So he says, wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Amen. Done how much? All. You know, one of the things I thought about is Jesus telling the disciples to get a sword. Notice this. What is a sword primarily? It's a weapon, right? But if you're in a battle, what side of the battle or are you carrying if you're wielding a sword? You're taking what kind of a posture? An aggressive? Offensive, right? So you're on the offense, swinging. And what is the enemy or your opponent doing? Retreating and defending, right? I was thinking about this and I said, it's kind of funny. The story of Jericho tells us that the people, when they were preparing for the invasion of Israel, stayed behind a wall, right? They were behind a wall, why? For protection. The night of the fall of Babylon, and I don't know if you've ever read about Babylon, but Babylon had walls that it is reported that was so wide that you could line up four chariots on the wall. Four chariots side by side on the wall of Babylon. And they felt that they were secure because they were behind these walls. Jesus never told us in our journey and in our warfare that we're supposed to get behind protection. He said you're supposed to wield the sword of offense, which means you take the fight to the enemy. We're not supposed to really just come to church and sit down. We're supposed to literally get up and go out. We're supposed to be about witnessing, taking the word of God to the communities. That's what we're supposed to be doing. But Nevertheless, verse 17, and you were right, when he says, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the what? Now, I'm going to tell you all something. I make absolutely no apologies, none, for being a Seventh-day Adventist. I like to tell the story about when I was 12 years old and I was a Methodist in the Methodist Church, had been so-called christened when I was a baby, grew up in a family of Methodists. All of my siblings and myself, we all were in the home with our grandparents or our grandmother, because our grandfather had died. And she raised us in the Methodist Church. And when I got to the age of 12, we had what was called a confirmation class. And in that class, you had to learn the Ten Commandments, the 23rd Psalms, the Lord's Prayer, the Beatitudes. I mean, all of this by memory. And you had to be able to stand up in front of the whole church and recite whatever they asked you to recite. But I had a problem. I asked my pastor, why are we coming to church on Sunday? And he said, what are you talking about? I said, you told us to memorize the Ten Commandments, and it said, repeat this with me, church, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, nor thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, and rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. And I said to him, it happened to have been a Sabbath when we were in there doing this class for confirmation. And I said, that's today. And I said, I don't understand why we coming on Sunday when it said, remember the seventh day. And he said, we do it because of tradition. That was an honest answer. But as I grew up, I began to realize something. All of us who are parents understand this one thing. We don't let our children run over us without a fight. Think about this. You let your child in your home that you work hard and pay to keep in existence tell you how to run your house? Well, if we have enough sense to know how to raise our children, don't you think God have enough sense to know how to control his creation? So, I realized that if the Bible didn't say it, tradition was not good enough. Now, let's get to the dilemma. So you got 11 disciples being told to take two swords. Jesus says it's enough. Paul comes along and he says that the sword of the Spirit is what? The Word of God. So how many do we have? Two. Christ said what? It's enough. Okay, let's go to Revelation chapter 1. We're going to go to Revelation chapter 1. And we want to, let's just go to chapter 1, verse 1. Revelation 1 and verse 1. The revelation of whom? Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto his servant things which must shortly come to pass. And he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John. Keep going. We're gonna read down. Who bear record of the word of God and wait a minute. He bear record Of what? There are two things here. You notice this? He said he's bearing record of the word of God, and that's a conjunction that joins. Okay, keep going. Verse 3. Blessed is he that read it, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, and the time is at hand. Now, what is he saying? He's pronouncing a blessing on they that hear the words of this prophecy. Go back to verse 2. And bear record of the word of God and of the... Is that a part of the prophecy? Is there a blessing on those who hear the words of that prophecy? And what's the prophecy about? The word of God and... Okay, verse 4. You see, this is necessary. And I'm going to tell you why it's necessary. I want you to have a microphone. Derek, please. Yes, let the young brother have the mic. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, and Revelations chapter 1, verse 2, what about all the things he saw?
What about the what?
If you go back to Revelation.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. In the testimony of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
In all the things he saw.
Yes. Well, that's right. You're right. Okay.
You
want to say something else? Go ahead.
No, I was just wondering, like...
Okay,
okay. That part of the story?
Okay. But I'm making a point. Remember, the sermon title is what? Those swords. Okay? No. The Holy Spirit, as a matter of fact, this is really great because people have the idea that people like me could stand up and teach you. Mm-mm. Jesus said, when he, the Spirit of truth, shall come, I went through this and decided I wasn't going to do this, but I'm not, and I'm not. In the Greek New Testament, there is never a gender put on the Holy Spirit. When it was being transcribed into English, those interpreters wrote in he. That's not in Greek. Now, some people will say they don't care about Greek. They just give them the Bible. Okay, well, that's fine. But I'm just letting you know that the Holy Spirit's responsibility is to teach you. But if you don't put yourself in a position to be taught, you're not going to learn. Okay, so we're going to verse, what verse are we going to? 4. John, to the 7 churches which are in Asia, grace be unto you and peace from him which is and which was and which is to come, and from the 7 spirits which are before his throne. Verse 5, he says, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins and his own blood. Verse, and hath made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. John is describing what all Christians look like. All Christians look like what he's talking about. We are all called to be kings. We are all called to be priests. There's no such thing as a common person in the house of God. All of us have the very same character to build, the character of Christ. And you can't obtain that character if you choose to leave out the instructions that will get you the character. Verse 7. Behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they which pierced him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. And verse 8. I am the beginning and the ending, saith the Lord, which is and which was, which is to come, the Almighty. Verse 9. I, John, who also am your brother and companion in tribulation and in the kingdom and the patience of Jesus Christ, was in the isle that is called Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. You know, some I have been in some of Adventist churches, and I don't think that we understand that we have a specific responsibility. And God did not ask us to vote on it, to debate it, to try to figure it out. As a matter of fact, I've shared from the desk before that God's word is so simple. But because we have an idea that God is so vast and so big, we have to try to interpret his word in a complex environment. This is simple. John said, I am a companion with you to become a king and a priest. And I was in the Isle of Patmos because of the word of God and... Some people will tell you they don't believe that they need to read the testimony of Jesus Christ. Well, I got news for you. And I've sat down with some pretty bright minds. And we share things like some people who study theology do. Did you know that the Bible is written, basically we know that we have the Old Testament and we have the New Testament, right? The Old Testament, according to Christ, when he faced the devil, said, it is written, man shall not live by what? Bread alone, but by how many words? Every word. Well, tell me something. How many testaments did we have during the life of Christ? How many testaments? One. How do you know? How do you know that you didn't have the New Testament? Well, I could hear answers, but I can't hear it that well. So, still can't hear you. Brother Derek, you have to help the saints with a mic. I want to hurry up and get done with this.
He's pretty much initiated, and as the church got started, the prophets and everybody like Paul, matter of fact, Paul wrote 13 epistles of the
He's credited with 14, really, but if you call Hebrew. Okay, that's good. So, because of time, I got to move this. Well, Rosa, we'll take your comment, and then we're going to move this. And the reason why I want you all to use that mic is because people are hearing this online. Go ahead.
My answer is that Jesus referenced the Old Testament.
Right. Exactly. Well, okay, so here's the point. Brother Elder said it. You can't have a New Testament if 14 of the books are going to be written by somebody who killed in the church. Think about this. Paul was persecuting the church, right? Where's the New Testament? This man killing us. So when Jesus said, you should live by every word, that's the word of God. We had yet to get the testimony of Jesus Christ. Now, if you read the writings of Paul, and let me tell you, this is like so interesting. The reason why Satan does not want us to have the testimony of Jesus Christ is because the testimony of Jesus Christ exposes him and his ways of doing things to bring down the church.
How long
The Word of God builds the character of the individual. But the testimony of Jesus Christ teaches those who have the character how to walk. Do you ever notice that when you read the epistles of Paul, Paul went up on Mars Hill. He saw a place of worship. And then he saw inscribed on an object, I don't know if it was wood or stone, to the what? Unknown God. And what did he do? He revealed it. And then he said to them, you guys are too superstitious. Well, tell me, who leads the art of superstition? Who does that?
The devil.
The devil. So when Paul was writing, he was doing what? Exposing the devil. So the New Testament then began the works of the spirit of prophecy, which we call the testimonies of Jesus Christ. Now, let's go to Revelation chapter 12. And we're wrapping this up. Revelation chapter 12, verse 17. I don't have time to set this up. So Revelation 12, 17. We want to get that. And the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. You notice how that language is still the same? Somebody is going to have the testimony of Jesus Christ. And let me tell you, I always say that I talk a lot. Sometimes I say the wrong things. And sometimes I think about some of the things I want to say, and then I share it with Claudette. She said, don't say that. Yeah, she did that this week. You have to understand that God loves you. You have to understand it. You have to understand that God will bless you. He will bestow blessings on you in order to draw you to himself. And it's not easy for God to have to take away the blessings in order to get your attention. I said to a cousin of mine once, when you make a declaration that you have accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, Jesus Christ makes a declaration back. And he says, I will never leave you or... So what happens if you decide that you no longer want to keep walking with the Lord and you walk away from God? Who did that? That's what we do though. I did it. I'm not proud of it. And I broke a lot of hearts. He doesn't leave us. And he does not forsake us. Ruby, Eddie still is in good hands. Let me tell you something. If you are a Seventh-day Adventist, stop trying to change what God has established. He gave us the Word of God and you can't do, and listen, you will never understand how Satan is attacking you as long as you decide that you are going to neglect any part of what God gave us in those two swords. Get now. Or doing it by yourself. We're going to end with this next text. Revelation chapter 14 and verse 12. This is our last Bible text. And believe it or not, I wanted to do this whole thing in 15 minutes. I knew I was in trouble. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that do what? Keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Well, let me tell you, when you read that, the study of the Word of God is very complex. Believe me, it's very complex. But I'm going to tell you what that is saying if you saw it in the Greek text. What it is saying, And like I told you, the Bible is not written in chapters and verses. It's just a book. When John wrote this, this is what John said when he saw that group. He said, this group who keep the commandments and have the faith of Jesus, have the faith of Jesus because those who had the testimony of Jesus preached that message and taught the testimony so much that they could now see how Satan was working, and they stood fast on the principles of God's word based on what Jesus gave the church, because those people who had the testimony stood firm, and many of them lost their lives, that this group could now have that faith. And they said, and according to the scripture, when you see this in original language, says they would not give that up. They won't give it up. So my question to us as a church today is this. If there are going to be some faithful people that's going to stand fast and hold on to God's testimonies, and you're sitting under the sound of my voice, are you going to give up what God has given us to give to ourselves, our children, and the world, and others who are going to be blessed by some of us who are going to be faithful? Are you prepared to make a decision to not be faithful? Are you going to give up what God gave us in those two swords for your salvation and for the salvation of others? Are you willing to give it up? I don't know if somebody is bold enough to stay seated on this appeal. And I'm not going to ask you to come back down. But if you are determined to accept the swords that Jesus has given us for this battle, which are both offensive, if you are determined to be saved with the Lord and carry out what we have been given to do, I'm going to invite you to stand. And if you are not, if you have not yet come to understand that you can fall in love with all of what God has given us for our salvation, if you have not yet discovered that, I'm inviting you to do so. Let us pray. Everlasting Lord, we are thankful, for you have given us much. We have given little. In many cases, Lord, we have not even given anything. But we come before you asking today that you will help us, Lord, that the decisions we make to receive all of your word and your testimonies might be sealed in our hearts. We would now turn around, go back to our homes, and begin to download the spirit of prophecy, which is found in the writings of Ellen White, to the end that we should study those writings, Lord, and follow the instructions given to have a closer walk with you. Seal us in this decision, we pray, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
We must stand in for our closing song, which his name was sweet.
Take the name of Jesus with you, child. precious name, oh, how sweet. Open heart and joy of heaven.
Let us pray. Now may the grace of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us all, we pray. And Lord, we ask that you will continue to bless us, that as we partake of the bread that has been set aside for our nourishment, we might remember all of your bounties to be grateful and thankful to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
God be with you till we meet again.